Okay, guys, let's take a look at our lesson for today. We're going to look at extrema on an interval. We're going to talk about extrema in general. You should have had some experience with that last year in pre-cal. Extrema means maximums and minimums. We're going to look at two different types of extrema. And we'll really be working mostly with extrema on an interval today, although I will introduce relative extrema. So let's first basically start with the definition. So the definition of extrema. First of all, let F be defined on an interval containing an X value they're calling C. So we're defined on the interval. We contain this X value called C. Notice it's saying the F of C, the Y value. The Y value is the minimum of the function on the interval if that Y value is the smallest of the function. And that makes logical sense, right? That's all this is, just it's writing it out in a mathematical form, but it just makes logical sense. And this Y value, F of C, this Y value would be the maximum of the function on the interval if that Y value is the largest Y value in the function. Pretty straightforward. So these types of extrema on an interval, they have a couple different names, so we need to go over vocab. One is called absolute, so absolute minimum or absolute maximum. The other vocab word, I mean, it means the same thing. There's nothing different between an absolute minimum or a global minimum. They mean the very tallest or the very smallest Y value in an interval, on an interval. Okay, so those are called extreme values or extrema. Those are all just words that are interchangeable that they would ask a question about. So that is our extrema on an interval. Now let's talk about relative extrema instead of global or absolute. Relative extrema, we are now on an open interval. Okay, we're no longer on a closed interval. With relative extrema, we can talk about it on an open interval containing this X value on which the Y value is a maximum. Then notice how they put the point here. X, Y is called the relative maximum. They love it in point form. It'd be great if you did that. But the actual, if they ask you for the minimum, they are talking about the Y value. They're not talking about the X value. Because how do we know if it's a minimum? It's not the X value that makes it the minimum, right? It's the Y value that makes it the minimum. It's the very lowest value. Or it's the Y value that makes it the maximum. And that is one of the biggest mistakes that I see students make, is that when it asks for minimum or maximum, we just write the X value. Well, that only tells us where the minimum and maximum occurs. It doesn't tell us what it is. So really important distinction. When it asks for minimum and maximum, they're really looking at Y value. If you want to give them the X value, that's fine. You can write it in a point form like this, but don't forget to give them the Y value, okay? All right, so, or you can say that the function has a relative maximum at that location. If there is an open interval containing this value C on which this Y value is a minimum, then this point is called the relative minimum. Or you can say it has a relative minimum at. This is just helping with vocabulary. How would Y say that? What does that mean? Open interval just includes, usually it's just the graph itself. If we're looking for some type of extrema on a graph, it would be on an open interval. Today we're going to be really focusing on a closed interval, but we will work with open intervals in a bit. You can have relative extrema on a closed interval too, and I'm going to show you an example in just a second where you can see that. All right, so relative maxes and mins are also called local maxes and mins. And so before we start in this technical stuff, we do need to talk about the difference between relative and extreme. So I'm just going to draw, you know, a diagram. And we're going to, this will be our interval, this would be our A, and this would be our B. Okay? So, on this particular example, our relative Well, let's start with global or absolute. This location right there would be our absolute max. That's the very tallest Y value in the whole area, in the whole interval. That's our absolute max. And let's pick out our absolute min. Our absolute min would be the very lowest Y value. This would be our absolute min. Okay. We also have something called relative. And if you think about it, you can think about these as mountains if you want to. If I'm standing on the top of here, that's pretty tall. Right? If I look to my left, I look to my right, it's the tallest place in that area. This part right here. If I look that way, that's smaller. I look this way, it's smaller. This is the very tallest point in this area. This is called a local or relative max. I'll call it a local max. That's what that is a local max. It's the highest point in the area. So to determine if you have a local or relative max or min, you have to be able to look to the left and look to the right to see that you are. If I'm at this endpoint, can I look to the left and look to the right to see if it's the bottom, the very tallest or very smallest? I can't. So there's no relative maxes and mins at the endpoints. They would occur in the interior. This certainly could be an absolute max or min. It could be the very smallest point or the very tallest point. It's not, but that could occur at the endpoints. And so we have another, this would be called, what would that, a relative min, or, well, just relative or local, however you want to, whichever word, that would be a relative min, okay? And these endpoints in this particular case are nothing, all right? They're not, because the only thing an endpoint can be is absolute. It can't be relative, because I'm not able to look to the left, to the right to make sure that I'm the tallest in the area or the smallest in the area. Okay? So that's the difference between those. All right, now let's get into a really important concept called critical points. An interior point of the domain. I have this blocked out because that is so important. It has to be in the domain of the original function to be a critical point. And that sounds like, well, of course. But you'll see it's possible for you to get a value, let's say, of 0 out of the derivative. And 0 is not in the domain of the original function. So it's not a critical number. Okay? And we'll look at different situations. So it's really important to note that in order to be a critical point, or critical numbers, some textbook calls them, you have to be in the domain of the original function, period. If it's not in the domain of the original function, it's not qualified. All right, so here's what critical points are. They're actually two types. And I just want to say that the type two students usually forget about, and they're probably very sad about that they're forgotten about. So let's not forget them, okay? Type one, the first type of critical numbers or critical points is this type right here, where the derivative is 0. That is the first type. And it actually is so important, it has a fancy name. It's called a stationary point. This is a popular formula quiz question. What is a stationary point? I have asked that in the past, and I have gotten some very strange answers. Okay? Very strange answers. Points that don't move. It's like, what? No. Okay? A stationary point is the type of critical point where the first derivative is 0, period, or the derivative is 0. That's a stationary point. So it's like a vocabulary quiz almost. Sometimes questions on the formula quiz have to do with vocabulary. All right, so that's type one. Type two is where the derivative is undefined. That is the second kind of critical point. And it doesn't come naturally to us sometimes. We know how to find the derivative set equal to 0. We have fun with that. We know how to find the zeros. But what about the poor little undefined guys? What about them? All right, now when would we have, why would that matter? When would the derivative be undefined and there be a maximum? Cusp, a cusp, and a corner, right? Couldn't I have a graph that comes up like that? And that's actually a maximum point, but it's not going to be defined and the derivative doesn't exist there? That's why these types, these poor little number two guys, are listed. There could be a maximum there, or there may not be. But they have to at least be tested. Okay, so those are the two types of critical numbers. And related is this theorem right here, that notice it says relative extrema, it's not talking about absolute, relative extrema can only occur at critical numbers, period. Okay? So these two, this definition and this theorem are related. This is what a critical point is. That's what you use them for. Relative extrema only occur at critical numbers. All right. So now let's, just a little bit of an example. Sorry, that bottom thing, I tried to clear it. It's there. But at any rate, this is our diagram. F has an absolute maximum at, we are on a closed interval. So our absolute maximum happens to be an endpoint. That could happen. This right here is our absolute maximum. So our absolute maximum is at 421. Okay, on that diagram. Our absolute minimum, pretty easy to determine right there. Is it negative 2, negative 15? And do we have a relative maximum? Yes, right here. Our relative maximum is at 0.5. And the question that you can't see that I tried to uncover is F has a relative minimum at? Yep, at 2.1. So that is at 2.1. All right, so we okay so far? Yes. All right, let's go to what we're going to do next is we're going to show how this is used and work some problems. So let's go to our second slide. Okay, another important theorem called the extreme value theorem. Of course, there's an if-then. You can only use the extreme value theorem if these things are possible. If f is continuous, this is criteria number one, if f is continuous and it's a closed interval. So to be able to use the extreme value theorem, those two things have to be true. If they are not, the extreme value theorem does not apply. Okay, so it has to be continuous, has to be a closed interval. If that is true, this theorem just tells us that if that's true, we're going to have both an absolute max and an absolute min on the interval. Period. That's all it says. So if you're on a closed interval and you're continuous, you will have an absolute max or min. Now, I had the question earlier, what if there are multiple, maxes of the same value, like all twos or something? Is that okay? Yes, that's okay. Just your maximum would occur at multiple locations. It's fine. Like, think about sine. Yeah, think about sine. I mean, what's its maximum value? One, and how many times does it occur? A lot, right? Infinity. So it is possible to have more than one of the exact same type of max or min, so that don't let that distress you. We would just list them if possible, or with like a trig function, we would write a general solution for it to list them all. Mm-hmm. It would be all of it. Yep. All right. Maybe you could write it on an interval. That would be weird, but you could. All right, so now this test right here is a really big deal. The candidate's test. Now, they don't call it the candidate's test on the AP test, but I can tell you that the mathematicians grading it call it the candidate's test. And I have seen problems where you actually get points for just finding the candidates. You don't even have to know whether they're the right or wrong. You just have to find them. So it's really important, the candidate's test, and we're going to talk about how this works. The candidate's test is for finding extrema on a closed interval, and that's really our focus for today, is the extrema on a closed interval. So this is how you would do it. Step one, you would find the derivative and all the critical numbers of the function in AB. And we just talked about there are two types of critical numbers, right? Where the derivative is zero, which are called stationary points, and the poor little number twos that people forget are the undefineds. Okay, we don't want to forget the undefineds. So there are two types, we would do that. Then step two, we would evaluate. This is a mathy word, evaluate f at each critical number. What does evaluate mean? Calculate, right? Put the x value in and find the y value. That's what that means. Evaluate means, do your arithmetic. Put the x value in, find the y value at each critical number in the open interval and at the endpoints. and at the endpoint. So we identify the candidates. The candidates will be critical numbers of the derivative, and they will be endpoints. Then we evaluate them all. The smallest is the minimum, and the greatest is the maximum. Like, you got your winner, they win, right? Smallest in the, and that's why we want to evaluate them. We want to see what their y values are. Okay, so that's the candidates test. Let's practice it on these two examples. They want us to find the absolute maximums and minimums of f on the given closed interval and state where the values occurred. Let's pull this apart. Find the absolute maxes and mins. What particular value are they speaking of? The y value. Maxes and mins are y values. Okay? Y values. On the given closed interval and state where they occur. What are they asking here? The x value. Okay? We need to be sure we understand what they're asking. So we would, on the first one, let's start it out. We find our derivative. So bring that down. That would be what? 2x, so negative 1/3 minus 2. Our closed interval right here is negative 1 to 8. Now we solve. We basically set it equal to 0. I'm going to rewrite this. 2 over cubed root of x minus 2. I would move the 2 over. Well, there's a lot of ways to solve this. I'm just kind of taking you through a basic way. Then I would cross product. Get 2 cubed root of x equals 2. So cubed root of x is 1. So x is 1. Okay, that is a critical number. Is that my only critical number? No, probably not. I got to check for undefineds. Is the derivative undefined? It is, right? Well, let's be more specific. Is it undefined between negative 1 and 0? The derivative, this guy right here. He is, isn't he? Where? At 0. So now let's make sure. So we found out that it's undefined at 0. Is 0 in the domain of the original function? Yes, so it's a valid critical number. If it wasn't, then we could not use it. Okay? It's valid. It is in the domain of f, so we can use it. So our critical numbers are x equals 1 and x equals 0. Those are our critical numbers. Now, what we want to do, I'm actually going to do steps 2 and 3 together. I'm going to evaluate the critical numbers and the endpoints, and that these are the candidates. So we want to find f of negative 1. We want to find f of 0. We want to find f of 1. And we want to find f of 8. We have just laid out the candidates. And on an AP test, very likely we would get a point for just writing the candidates down. We might even mess up our arithmetic and get the wrong answer, but we would get the point for writing the candidates down. Okay? So we go, now where do I check my y values for this? Do I go to the derivative? No, because if I go to the derivative, some of them are going to be 0 or undefined. That's not where I go, right? To check how high or low they are, I have to go to the original function. And so you would do that. And just for time, I'm going to write those down. So f of 0 is 1. F of negative 1 is 6. F of 1 is 2. And f of 8 is negative 3. So we look there. Our last task is pretty simple. Which is the very biggest y value and which is the very smallest? So the very biggest is 6. So we have an absolute, or you can call it global. We have an absolute max at negative 1/6. And we have absolute min. What is our absolute smallest value? At negative 3. So our absolute min is at 8, negative 3. And that is our first example for finding absolute extrema. Are we okay with the candidates test? It's pretty straightforward, right? We should follow the steps. Uh-huh. Right, if we wanted to find relative, we would put the critical numbers on a number line and do a sign chart, and we will get to that later, not today. Uh-huh. So why was 0 a critical number? 0 is a critical number because it's an undefined value in the derivative. So it's the critical number type 2. Okay, where is Where is the first derivative undefined? No, we don't. We wouldn't deal with those. Mm-mm. Okay. So let's take a look at our next question. We're going to find the derivative. This little guy right here, let me just say, has caused lots of people heartache because we don't remember how to take the derivative of him. Oh, poor thing. It's a power chain. The derivative of that is not cosine squared. Okay, it is not. So please don't fall into that trap. Remember when we first learned it, I suggested that you rewrite it like that so that you wouldn't miss the power chain. And so we're doing the derivative, it would be the power chain. So I bring the two down, copy paste to the first, and then the derivative of sine is cosine. Okay, then the derivative of cosine is negative sine. All right, so that's my, we're doing candidates test and everything on example two. Now, I'd set it equal to zero, and before, now some of you are going to get really excited and want to divide the sine off. Please do not do that. If you divide the sine off, you lose answers. We don't want to do that. Yes, algebraically, it's okay to move the sign over and divide it off, but it is a bad idea because we would lose answers. Instead, we want to factor. We want to factor. So, let's factor. So, sine x and then 2 cosine x minus 1. So, I set each factor equal to 0. Sine x equals 0, 2 cosine x minus 1 equals 0. So we need to think about our unit circle, our lovely unit circle, and we're only interested in this interval from 0 to 2 pi. All right, so sine is 0 here and here, right? So it's 0 at 0, pi, and 2 pi. Okay, this one is, let's finish this out, move the 1 over, divide by 2. So we want to know where cosine is a half. So cosine is a half. Here and here. Okay, do you remember what value that is? Pi over 3. Cosine is a half at pi over 3. Now, don't do the negative rotation. I know I like negative pi over 3 too, but it's not in the interval. Mm-hmm. So the other would be 5 pi over 3. And that's type 1 of critical numbers. Let's think about type 2. Do we have any undefineds on this derivative in this interval? Is there any x value I am not allowed to use? No, so I don't have the type 2. And in fact, strangely enough, my endpoints are included in my critical numbers. So we're just going to do the candidates test. We have 5 candidates. Okay, we're going to do the candidates test on those 5 candidates. So let's write that out. So we're going to look for f of 0, f of pi over 3, f of pi, f of 5 pi over 3, and f of 2 pi. Okay, that's what we're going to look for. So we would go where to find those values? To the original function. And just for time's sake, I'm going to write those down. So f of 0 is 1, f of pi over 3 is 5 fourths, f of pi is negative 1, f of 5 pi over 3 is 5 fourths, and f of 2 pi is 1. All right, so we evaluate the candidates. We take a look. Let's see. The very smallest, we definitely have a winner. All right, be pi. So our absolute minimum is pi negative 1. What about our absolute maximum? We have two of them, don't we? So 5/4 would be our absolute max. So we have two locations. That would be at pi over 3, 5/4. And that would be at 5 pi over 3, 5/4. And those would be our absolute extrema on that closed interval. Okay? We okay?